Hi, welcome to Fab Conversations with Sonu Bhasin. Fab is families and business. And today we have with us Neha Oswal, who's a second generation inheritor of the family business, but she has branched out on her own and she has founded a completely new business, which is called Harvin Greens. It is a company that focuses on the development and implementation of high-tech greenhouses. And Neha is passionate about chemical-free produce and making it accessible to as many people as she can. Very, very noble intentions. And Neha, lovely to have you here. And let's get started.
Thank you so much, Sonu, for that lovely introduction. I'm so happy to be doing this.
Super. Thanks. So, Neha, you studied architecture in bachelor's. Then you went off to Milan to do design.
Yeah.
And then you did a boring MBA from ISP. So very interesting choices. So just tell us, how did you come about these three different choices?
Okay. So, you know, when you pass out of school, I think, you know, there are these ambitions and you're like, okay, let's do something different. So I thought architecture was very interesting at that point. I got admission into the Sashant School of Art and Architecture in Gurgaon, which was quite prestigious. So I pursued architecture. I did 5 years of architecture. While I was studying architecture, I realized that my flair is probably more towards the design side. So I was quite intrigued with interiors and lighting. So I went to Italy to pursue that. And that was very interesting because, you know, once I went abroad, a new world opened up for me. I saw a lot of different things, even in the design world. And I came back. So when I came back, I set up a studio of myself. This was a design studio. And I worked a couple of years in the design field. But, you know, we had this business and it was sprawling. It was doing very well. And, you know, it's me and my sister. So we're two daughters. And there was always this discussion of how to take it further, who's going to take it on. So by the time I got back, you know, that had already begun. So I think very gradually, and it was a very natural decision to kind of get into business, because I think, you know, design is always there. Design is something, whether you study it or you're pursuing it on an everyday basis, whether it's life, design is always there, a part of it. But I think the business kind of needed to move to the next leap. So I felt it was the right time. I did my course at ISP. I felt empowered. And that's how I started. I joined. Yeah.
So, you know, you're one of the few people who first decided that you wanted to join the business and then did an MBA. Normally, it's the other way around.
Yeah.
But you said you're two sisters and your sister lives in London. So you are the one that's here in India and in Delhi. So was there some kind of a pressure on you, invisible pressure to join the business? I mean, you were running your own successful design business.
Yeah.
So was there any pressure of any kind that you felt?
I don't think I'll call it pressure, Sonu, but you know, as a child, when your father's running this business and you can see that he could do with some help, I think it comes to you naturally. You feel like, okay, kind of responsible and it kind of seems like a bit of a duty as well to kind of help him out. So there was no pressure, but of course, you know, as parents, you know how Indian parents are. They do end up saying this sometimes in their conversation, that it would be great if somebody could kind of join. So I wouldn't call it pressure, but I think it came more from my side. I felt that I should take it on, and that's why I joined.
So good, dutiful daughter, it would seem. Yes. Right? That's the right upbringing. The right upbringing from your parents, that they don't have to do too much, but just suggest something.
Yeah.
And the dutiful daughter is going to say, yes, Papa, of course I will do this. Right?
That's how it is. That's exactly how it is for most of the things.
Yeah. So you're talking about your dad. So just tell us about the business that your dad built, a little about the business that you joined.
Okay. So we started back in 82. So my father we were the first people to bring in PE-based sprinkler systems in the country. So it was quite an innovation back then. My father otherwise is from St. Stephen's, you know, he started chemistry. So again, for him also, he just kind of ended up starting this business. It was not, it's not like a family business. So he's the first generation entrepreneur. We started this, we got national award for innovation. Down the line, we've been doing very interesting things. So we do a lot to do with water conservation. So whether it's drip irrigation systems or sprinkler irrigation systems or water filtration, fogging systems. So we like to call ourselves a water conservation company because everything that we do kind of helps conserve water. So that's what we've been doing over these years. We've essentially been focusing on the rural market. So a big part of our business is in rural India. We've got offices pan India across the country. We've got warehouses. So, you know, that's how it began. And then in 2006, we had a joint venture with the Spanish company called Azud, which is the world leader in drip irrigation systems. So together as a JV, we set up a manufacturing plant, which is in Bawal in Haryana. It's a state-of-the-art factory. I think one of the few factories that are so modern and so high-tech. So, you know, that's when things started changing for us, actually, for my father. Once he got into the JV, I think, again, like I said, you know, when you partner with an international partner, another world opens up. So I think that's the time that a lot of interesting things happened. And that's when we grew multifold after the JV.
So that's actually quite interesting, Neha. But then when you did decide to join the family business, I think you do realize that you are among that very, very small percentage of daughters who actually join the core business of the father. And, you know, while you've been successful in carving out an identity for yourself, there are many young daughters-in-law out there, maybe even young wives who are out there, who also have the same ambitions about joining the family business, and they're apprehensive.
Yeah.
Can you share with us your experiences of joining a family business as a daughter so that others can take a lesson from it?
Okay. So I think, you know, when people say daughter and son, frankly, so no, I don't understand that because like I said, we are two daughters and we've not seen it any other way. So, you know, it's always been us. If one was to join the business, it was either of the girls. So I think, women and men, I don't think that's the issue. I think, of course, in 2016, when I joined the business, it was challenging because, you know, it was an established setup. And I think anyone who wants to join their family business needs to think of these things, you know, that it's going to be slightly difficult because there is a lot of expectation when you set foot, you know, you're coming as kind of the second generation. People expect you to know a lot of things. And especially in the field that I am in agriculture and this irrigation industry, it's a very male-centric, male-dominated field. So I did have some challenges there because anywhere that I speak or any meeting that I attend, I'm actually pretty much the only woman out there. So that's the only time that I feel that, okay, that's a little bit, you know, I feel that, okay, I'm the woman out in the entire forum or let's say, even in the industry, there are very, very few women. But other than that, I think it's just how you take it, you know. You need to be aware that it's a running establishment. You need to really go slow into, you know, trying to make changes. I think that's been pretty challenging because, like I'd mentioned to you while we were talking that, you know, the first year that I joined the business, I pretty much just did not speak much. You know, I was an observer. And I think everyone in the company was wondering what's happening because this new person had joined but had no inputs. So they were like kind of confused. But that was the tip that my father gave me that, you know, just observe for a year. Just don't try and implement too many changes. Don't try to put in too many new ideas because it'll have a problem in the people accepting you. So I think that was a great tip. So for all the people, all the women out there who are wanting to join their family businesses, and I think it's a great idea. I think they must. It's just that before you do that, take that big leap, just have a strategy in place because, you know, I mean, even though I don't see any difference between a woman or a man, but you know how our society is. Sometimes a woman, inheritor is needs to prove herself a little bit more in that sense.
Yeah, but I don't think it's only the woman inheritor who has to prove herself more.
Yeah.
Whether you look at the corporate world, you look at the professional world, and I do talk to a lot of women outside of family businesses. I think it is women in general. Once they reach a certain position where the men start seeing them as actual threats, that they have to start proving themselves a little more than an average male. But I guess, like you said, you can't change it. And if any of the women inheritors wants to make a difference, wants to join the business, I think they just have to get on, tighten the belt and get on with it. I mean, there are no easy ways in life. But talking about women joining the family business, let me just flip the question a bit. You know, there are fathers, uncles, brothers who are part of the family business. And sometimes it is them who are not very welcoming of the idea of a woman coming and joining the core business.
Yeah.
What do you have to say to them in general?
I think everyone has to find a way for themselves, something that works. What I learned was that, you know, sometimes as youngsters, we like to do things very quick and we want to turn around things and we want to prove ourselves very quickly. I think that probably sometimes works against us rather than for us, you know, because whether it's an uncle or a brother or anyone who's been in the system, I think we should just, you know, get into it slowly, steadily, make a place for us, for you know, you have to make a place for yourself before you make any changes or demand anything to change.
Yeah.
So I think it's we've got to deal with it. It's a part of the stride. But as long as you can prove yourself and prove your mettle, I think everyone's going to be welcoming at the end of the day.
So, you know, what I find interesting is that you did join a business set up by your dad, but you very quickly identified a new area, which was hitherto unexplored by your dad.
Yeah.
So did you do it just to get out of his hair? And did he agree so that you could get out of his hair? Why did you decide to diversify into a new business? And tell us a little about that business.
Sure. So, you know, I joined the business in 2016. And like I mentioned, our business is primarily rural and agriculture is, you know, in the rural part of the country. So I think once I joined the business, also my exposure in Italy kind of opened up my horizons, and I realized that we're missing a very big segment, which is the urban segment. And frankly, I also connected better with that segment. You know, I felt for me to go and do rural marketing was not a correct fit. So when I saw myself joining the business and taking it forward, I thought I should do something that I can be true to. And that's how urban farming came into the picture. Because I studied architecture, I got into the space of designing structures. You know, these are climate controlled structures which help you to grow in urban spaces very efficiently.
But so large urban spaces or small urban spaces?
I mean, it depends. It could be, for example, our clientele today are corporates who are growing, you know, who are setting up big projects where they want to export or they want to supply to, let's say, a Reliance or a food hall. So those are our clients. Then, of course, the government sets up these huge demonstration centers for the farmers, you know, to learn. So that's another clientele that we have. We are working with the universities, several universities like Hisar University, Punjab University, you know, they have the agriculture school where they set up these state of the art kind of projects, you know, to teach the students. So we are doing that. So, you know, I thought when I joined the business, to try and change too many things in an existing setup, I felt was very challenging. And also my father is very active. I must tell you that he's very active in the business. So, you know, two people steering the same boat can get, there can be too much contradiction. So I think as a strategy, we realized, I'll be truer and more fit for the urban business. And B, it also helps us kind of have our own space. You know, he can take his decisions primarily, and I can take mine. And of course, we're there to kind of guide each other, discuss everything. Yeah. So that's how it kind of, you know, the new business, which the new company is called Harville Greens. And, you know, in the past, you must have heard there's this big buzz about organic, chemical free, farm to fork. So I'm very, very convinced that that is the way forward. And especially because of COVID, I think the people's mindsets have changed completely. The focus is on health. So I think the timing was perfect. People are getting more aware, the youngsters, everyone is getting into the space of wanting to grow their own food, wanting to eat fresh, wanting to eat clean. So I saw a lot of opportunity there.
Yeah. So, you know, I think I find it fascinating. And you're right that, you know, because of COVID, this focus on good, clean, organic food has come back. And add to the fact that everybody turned a chef during the pandemic because all the meals were out. So there is a huge opportunity. But unfortunately, most of us don't live in farmhouses. Most of us don't have large tracts of or pieces of land that could be converted into these high-tech greenhouses. And then in the past, you've talked to me about hydroponics.
Yes.
Do you see any way that an average person living in an average house in an average city could also use some of your technology to grow their own food and eat right?
So absolutely. In fact, I think, you know, during this pandemic, all of last year went into R&D for Harville Greens. We have come up with wonderful options, which can be as small as, you know, having a unit on your balcony. It could be having it on a terrace. So we have come up with these a new product range where we have small greenhouses, say 160 square meters or 150 square meters, you know, whatever, let's say a 500 square yard house, you've got a terrace, you can set up a greenhouse. We give you the growing systems, which are hydroponics. So again, growing, there's no problem of soil and insects and infestation. We take care of all of that because you're growing in water and you grow your own greens. And additionally, we automate the whole system for you. So you know how during the pandemic, nobody was having their part-timers come in, no Malis. We saw that as a big opportunity and we've come up with this complete system where everything is automated. So you have a button, whether it's on your terrace or in your house, You turn that on, the drip system works, the plants get irrigated. There's a system where you can check the EC and pH, which is, you know, to check if the fertilizers and everything are going right into the system. And there's a timer where you control when you want to turn it on and when you want to turn it off. So it's become very high-tech and very simple. You know, usually high-tech people think, oh my God, it's going to be really difficult. But this is a very simple system where actually you can have it on your phone. Yeah. So let's say you're traveling to Bombay, you're not worried that the Mali is not coming and the plants will die. You know, you have an app, you turn on your irrigation system, you check if everything is fine. So I think that way, you know, it's getting very interesting because there are a lot of options that we've come up with.
Yeah, I think, you know, as even as you speak, I think I find it hugely fascinating. And the fact that ordinary people can actually grow their own food and eat good, healthy and clean food. So yeah, more power to you and hope more people who are listening to this get converted to good food. Absolutely. So, you know, whatever you've described, you know, I look at it as entrepreneurship, but I want to ask you, what do you think when the word entrepreneurship is used? What are top two qualities that an entrepreneur needs to have? And is entrepreneurship an inherited quality or can it be learned?
Okay, so to me, entrepreneurship is you know, firstly, the most important thing is to try and solve a problem. I think entrepreneurs are the ones who are solving in a problem, you know, wherein, let's say I realized during the pandemic that it's a problem that people could not let their gardeners come in and they were kind of finding it difficult as to going, whether they had a big lawn or they had a terrace garden. It was a tricky situation. So that's the kind of space that I think entrepreneurs look for. You know, they look for an opportunity, they understand what is the problem and they find a way to solve it. So that's what I would say is entrepreneurship. Your second question was?
Qualities of an entrepreneur.
Qualities. Mm-hmm. I think
qualities.
So qualities again are to, you know, you need to understand your client. I think it's very important. So today, if I launch this model, which is very high tech, and I come to a realization that, you know, the woman of the house, or let's say the housewife, is not really bothered and she's happy to go up and do it, it fails the purpose. So I think an entrepreneur needs to have a very good understanding of his product and his market. And of course, leadership skills and all of those are very important, because, you know, when you're setting up new teams and trying to do something innovative, you need to lead from the front and you need to, you know, kind of steer the boat. Yeah. So those qualities, of course, are essential.
And can you learn entrepreneurship, or is it something that you either have or you don't have?
Oh, I truly believe, Sonu, that there's nothing like you inherit it or anything like that. Of course, there are perks, because if you are born into a family which is into business, I think you know the tricks of the trade a little bit better, but you surely can learn them. You may take slightly longer, but you can definitely learn them. But another thing that comes with business, you know, is risk-taking. I think an entrepreneur also in that sense needs to have that ability to take risks, which somehow I feel that people who come from a business background or from family businesses, you know, they have that in them because they've always seen that. That's the only thing I think they have an edge, the family business inheritors have an edge towards. But other than that, you know, you can learn it. That's not an issue at all.
Yeah. When I hear you talking about risk, and I have asked this question of many entrepreneurs, I think what they say is that, you know, we have the ability of taking a risk, but we don't gamble. We take calculated risks. And we do know that some of the calls that we take may not turn out to be, the way that we thought of it. Yeah. But we still go ahead and take those risks, but we don't gamble. So, which I found very useful to understand from a risk-taking perspective. Yeah. Yeah. And when we talk that, you know, we have a risk appetite, it doesn't mean that, you know, we just go out and put everything on, as they say, Hindi mein sab daav pe laga diya, wo nahi karte hain, but you do take a calculated risk. Yeah,
absolutely. It has to be calculated. But, you know, sometimes when you're starting out on your own, a risk can be big or small, but you are fearful of taking it. So I think sometimes if you have a little push from the back, like in my case, I'm pretty conservative actually when it comes to taking risks. But then I have that little push from my father where he says, it's fine, it's okay. It sounds quite logical and let's go with the flow. You know, we'll see what happens.
Yeah.
That is a bit of an edge that's there.
Yeah. So, you know, we've spent a lot of time talking about the pandemic, and I think this pandemic has been tough on almost all of us, right? Yeah. How did you deal with the pandemic in the business?
So actually, for us, it was very new. I'll tell you why, because we're an old establishment, very used to working in office and office timings and, you know, very too used to that. So I think for us, working from home and all was very new. I mean, I know lots of companies have been doing it, but for us, it was a brand new thing. But frankly, it's turned out really well. I must say that in terms of business, of course, it's been terrible otherwise. But we have learned to work efficiently. We have put several systems in place which were not there in the past. Because, you know, remote working kind of, I think it can work very well as long as you have systems in place. So we spent the first few months of the pandemic trying to put the systems in place. And another very important thing that happened for us is that because we were not being able to get on the ground and do any sales and marketing in that sense, the marketing aspect, we went digital. So that was a completely big shift, which I think pre-COVID, nobody would have ever thought of that, because our business is agriculture, it's rural. You know, you tend to think, oh my God, you know, there's no need to get onto a digital platform. But we did that in the pandemic, where Harville Greens is, there's an e-commerce, there's an e-shop, which is doing very well because people are not being able to get out there and buy things. So e-commerce has been a big change. And other than that, also all our marketing efforts have shifted online. So that has been a big change. And I think going forward, that's really going to help us. Yeah. So in terms of business, I think we've had some good, very good changes in that sense.
Yeah. And are there any lessons that you've learned from the pandemic, from the crisis that hit all of us, that you're going to carry forward?
You know, frankly, touch wood, I must say agriculture is one industry which was not really impacted too much. So we realized the value of that, while, you know, industries like hospitality and so many others, retail came crashing down. Thankfully, agriculture has not been hit. In fact, we've seen a growth this year. So that was a big learning that, you know, we're in this space, which is so important. And as you know, our Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, he's constantly talking about agriculture, trying to push schemes, you know, because we work with the government as well. So I think we realized in this pandemic that, you know, it's agriculture is super important. Yeah. No matter what happens, that's one industry that is unimpacted in that sense.
Yeah. No, I agree, you know, extremely fortunate that did well. And I think as a country, we were blessed that, you know, the agriculture sector pulled us out of whatever mess otherwise we would have been. But Neha, you know, these are called FAB conversations, and FAB is families and business. So I cannot end this conversation without talking about your family. So tell us about your family and how did you all as a family deal with the pandemic?
Okay, so on a personal front, it's been great because I've got two little kids. My son is 6 and my daughter is 3. So I think the amount of time I've spent with them in the last year and a half has been tremendous. And, you know, I'm very thankful for that.
Are the children sick of you and saying, Mom, why don't you go?
In fact, I'm very worried that what's going to happen when we have to go back to work, because they're so used to having me and my husband around. I don't know how they're going to adapt, because for everything, it's like we're having, you know, we're together, even though, of course, we've set up our own workstations in different rooms. But they're just, you know, we've still, I think we've got a lot of good time with each other. So that way, I think it's been good. You know, we've been blessed because we had great and very quality family time.
Yeah. And is your husband also part of the business?
No, my husband is not part of the business. He also runs a hospitality company. It's also a tech company. So he's into another space. But because he's into the tech business, he helps me a lot. So the digital, when I had to take the business digital, he was my go-to person. He helped me to do many things, and still he advises me on several things. But yeah. I believe it's good to keep it separate. It's more peaceful. So we are happier like that.
Great. So Neha, you know, lovely hearing all about you and the work that you do. And thank you for speaking to all of us, and wish you all the best, and may India as a whole eat clean and healthy food in the future.
Thank you so much. I hope the little endeavor that we've started helps put clean food, chemical-free food on the table. And I hope your viewers get a chance to probably read a little bit about us. Search us on Instagram or YouTube. And definitely, I hope everybody eats clean, stays safe, because at the end of you know, the pandemic, that's what we've realized. Health is wealth.
Yeah. Thank you.